Now we want some kind of condition to end this scene. Or you know what we could do first that's actually more ideal? We could create that intro screen first. Yeah, let's do that. Oops. Gonna close this download tab here as well. So the wait screen is very similar to the dashboard. So I'm gonna create a copy of the dashboard layer. I'm gonna go to this method here. I'm gonna save this as, what should we call it, wait screen. Yeah, let's call it that for now. And it's gonna, let's just rename it here. So create dashboard layer should become create wait screen layer. It needs the font and it also needs the level, I think. Yeah, because it should print the level name as like the intro screen for the waiter. I don't think we need these lines here because we don't have the same complications with special lines. So I'm gonna remove that abstractions and then I'm gonna rename this to create draw wait screen. And then we are gonna print a font, but another thing, so let's update that. We're gonna print world and we're gonna print the level name, but a little bit differently. And we're gonna print the player lives. Gonna remove the things we don't need. So this, we don't need a timer trait. We don't need to find the player trait. Or do we do that? Yeah, we do, because we need to get show the lives on screen here. So I'm gonna keep this function and actually have a copy of this around. So let's remove that. And then I happen to know where we should draw this. So we should draw world and then plus the level name like this. And that should be drawn on the context and on some particular line. We're gonna put it on, where do we say, 8 times 12, because 8 is the font size. I guess we still want the font size. So let's abstract the font size here. Const size equals font.size. So we want to paint it at size times 12 from the left, and then size times 12 from the top. We should try that out at least. And let's just have that in there for now. I'm gonna remove that, and I guess it is enough. Just try to see if we draw another screen before we do too much. So let's go into the main, and just like we create the dashboard layer here, I want to create a wait screen. And that should be done after we start the level, or load the level, so to say. So let's type that out here, const wait screen layer. No, what is this called? This is actually the level, the status presentation, because, oh, yeah. So the wait screen is actually a composition of the dashboard and the current status of the progress and the life of the player. So I'm gonna actually rename this now to something like progress status, game progress, player progress. Yeah, player progress. So instead of calling this wait screen, I'm gonna call it player progress layer. And why not rename this to, probably should, player progress, and keep the other things as is for now. Then we go into main here and we set this up as player progress layer, and we run create player progress layer. It uses the font and it uses the level. And maybe we can just see if we can render this on top of the level for now. Fun. So we add that to the composition of the layer. just to make this a little bit more consistent, instead of creating this inline here, I'm gonna abstract it away, or just instantiate it with this layer here. So const dashboard layer equals create dashboard layer, and let's see what happens. Probably fastest route forward. So no, can't read properly name of undefined. So let's see what we did wrong here. The player progress, it takes the player trait, and it takes that probably before the player was in the level, I suspect. I'm just gonna double check on that. Yes, we don't add the player to the level until here, but that's actually a little bit, you probably don't want to bind the player immediately there anyway. So even though this is a little waste of resources, I'm gonna put that down here. And that this error wasn't actually in the player progress, was actually in the dashboard. But we should do this for both actually. So let's go into player dashboard here. And we don't have to use this for the timer trait because the level will always be the same. But let's move the player trait down here. And now you can see we are rendering world 1-2 on top of the screen here. What we also should render, we should render a Mario icon and the amount of lives Mario have here. Let's do that. Let's go into player progress here. And the way to render Mario is to... let's just... see if we can render it just like we render an entity. So we have Mario, we can find Mario here. So actually, let's remove this. Let's just rename this to get player instead. And instead of returning the entity, the player trait, we return the full entity, the first entity we defined. So this is now called get player. This is the player here. And then we could just try out to render the player on the screen there. So that should be as easy as saying just player.draw on the context. So now we have another extra player up there. He's a little bit offset, and the way we solve this is usually that we draw it on a buffer. So let's go into this, what do we have? The sprite layer. So I'm gonna copy the buffer here and do similar like we do here to move it around. So in the player progress, we set up a new buffer up here. Actually, we're gonna put size in the top. And the buffer, I'm just gonna put it to hardcode 32 in width and height, because that's what I want. And the buffer context can be there. And then we draw on the buffer context. And then we draw the buffer context on the incoming context. So, which means we should just be able to say context.draw image, and we draw the sprite buffer context. No, we actually draw the full buffer in the canvas. And we draw it at, I want it to be aligning with the font. So I'm gonna still say size here times 12 from the left, and then size times 15 from the top. So there we go, but we probably need to clear that before we redraw it. So we say sprite buffer context dot clear rect, and we clear it 0, 0, and we use the width and the height here. Sprite buffer width and sprite buffer dot height. So of course it shouldn't animate in the real world, but I think we don't probably have to worry about that, to be honest, because when we draw this layer, it's not going to be drawn on top of the level, it's going to be drawn on its own screen. So I don't want to worry about this preemptively. I think this is just kind of funny that we are drawing the player just as it is in that state. I actually think this is pretty cool. But let's add the amount of lives here, and then we should be done with that layer. Back into the code. And what do we have here? Hey, we should print something. So let's print that last. Down here, font print, and there should be an X, or I think it's actually a times number. No, what do you call it? A multiplication sign. And then we take the player dot player, because this is the trait there. Actually, just to be more consistent, I want to rename this entity. And we draw the entity.draw there, and then we get entity.player here. And some formatting. We want to print the lives, and we want to print it as two string. And then we need to pad it something. I'm gonna pad start with three spaces here. I should probably put this on another row. Let's put it like that, and let's put this on down here too, so we can fit it on the screen. Okay, where are we now? Are we not printing that now? Where did that go? Let's look in our code here. Font.print. Forgot to supply the context here. No, we didn't actually. There's the context. Better just copy this down here and see that we actually can draw something more. Did we get something wrong with the size, perhaps? No, that looks all right. I'm gonna move this up before we draw the odd level to get a view of what's going on here. Sure, we didn't get an error. No, that's not. Oh, we're actually drawing it on top here. So that's, we have probably got the numbers wrong down here. So let's lower it. 16 and 15 here. Ah, there we go. One row down still. So I guess that's, this could be 17. No, that was the left align. 16 looks good, and then put 16 here as well. What should be fun to see now is if we go into the coin level again, then this should update when we collect enough coins. So I'm actually going to load that, and it's called debug-coin. And we should see that counter go up. And that's pretty sweet. Now, what we need to do is take that layer and combine it only with dashboard and show nothing else for a while, and then show the level. So I'm gonna create a new scene here, and I'm gonna base that on the level, level class. So as I said before, that I see these levels as an abstraction of a scene, abstraction. So let's just save this, and I'm gonna save this as, what do we call this? Actually, we can do this generically. Let's just call this a composition scene.js. Yeah, and the level is basically an advanced. It has a composer here, but they also have tons of other things. But composition scene is going to be a simple variant of that. So let's name the class here composition scene. And no name, no gravity, no total time, no camera. It should have events, no music, but it has a comp, and no entity collider entities. We can keep this, but we drop the camera. And now, in the update loop, we don't actually need update loop, I think. But it is probably good to keep it. Yes, because what we need here, we need to be able to escape this at some time. So imagine we want to show this for some time, the composition scene. We need to update the timer. So let's add a count on here, count down, and we say put that at 2. And then here we, the only thing we do is basically this.countdown plus minus equals game context.delta time, I think. I think we have that. Yeah. So now what we should do here now is, how do we notify that we're done? Well, we can emit an event here. So if this.countdown is less or equal to 0, then we emit an event. So this.events.emit. And which event should we get? Actually, we can put an event on the scene runner class, I think. Even though that doesn't really make sense. It would be pretty nice to have a generic scene that is, let's do that. Sorry if I'm talking and thinking at the same time, but what I want to do is create a scene that has an event emitter and a compositor and nothing else, and then we extend from that scene for now. That means that the parent scene can have events on it that we can emit. So I think you would follow when you see what I do here. I'm going to create yet another instance of this, but first I'm going to clean up the things we don't need in this. Remove that, remove find players, because that only makes sense for the level. Saving this, then saving yet another copy of this, the calling scene.js. And this, of course, contains our named scene. It has an event emitter and compositor. It probably have a generic draw method, but it does not have an update method. But for consistency, I'm just gonna leave an empty update method here. So now we can actually use this scene in the level. So if we import that scene in here, import scene from scene, we can extend from that scene, extend scene, and now when we call super here in instantiator, that means we already have the event emitter there, and we also get the compositor from it. Let's keep those, and probably should run this before I change too much. So that seemed to work. Why did I get this error? Audio.play. Oh yeah, that's just because you have a silent level here. So let's just go into main.js and load our 1.2. So that's sweet. Now I want to add that. Let's pause music. Let's add a static here. Static event complete. And that's going to be a symbol as we're used to. Scene complete. Call that. And that means that now other things will be able to listen to the scene complete event on scenes if they know about the scene. So in our composition scene that we have here, we now emit that event. So we say scene.event complete. There we go. That means we need to import scene up here. Import scene. And we extend from that scene. Extends scene. Now we can call super. That means we get those others. those instantiated automatically. And should we update the draw method? What does the scene look like? So the default draw method of the scene actually does this. And I think we can keep it like that. So I'm not a super big fan of inheritance, but so far I think this is okay. One layer is usually fair to keep track of. So that means we don't need these because these are imported, they are created in the scene. And now we can set up a composition scene. We do that in main, and let's do that down here. I'm gonna call this the wait screen, and it's gonna be a new composition scene that was automatically imported. And the wait screen, we're gonna push some layers to that. We're gonna push the dashboard layer to it. So we just replace it with wait screen. Like that. And we also want to add the player progress layer to it. That means we remove the player progress layer from this level. There we go. And now we add the wait screen to the scene runner before the level. Add scene, wait screen. And let's see if this works. And that's a wait screen. And there it should have emitted an event, but it didn't do that. Or it did emit it, but we don't listen to it. So let's see if we can listen to the event. And here I run next, and here on the wait screen, we can add an event listener. So wait screen.events.listen, and we listen for scene event complete. And when that happens, we run, what is it? Scene runner.run next. I feel like this can be put into the scene runner, perhaps. Yeah, I think so. Let's see, why do I get these squiggly lines here? Did I forget something? Oh. That should be a callback, should be like that. Yeah, but let's put this in the scene runner actually. So, scene runner, blam. When you add a scene, it gonna add a listener to the scene as well. So, the wait screen, the scene here is a general name for the wait screen. So it's gonna say like that. So when the scene emits an event that is complete, we should run this.run next here. And then we push the scene. Let's see if this works. So the expected behavior now is that we get the wait screen for 2 seconds, then we run the next scene. Okay, start it, and we have an error. Not unexpected, quite a lot of things going on here now. Scene is not defined in the scene runner. That means we just need to import this. I think, can we get this out import if I do this? No. Okay, so let's import manually. Import scene from that's this.js. And let's have a look. Intro screen. Boom. Pretty sweet. Gonna take a look at the main file again, and in order to start another level, we should abstract, or not abstract, but let's put some of these level loading logic in a function that we can rerun whenever we need to. And that function I am gonna define down here, function run level. It's gonna take a level name, and it's gonna run the level. So it's gonna do the parts in here that is required to start a new level. So we're going to do it initially, then we're going to do it for every new level that we need to run. So I'm gonna just start moving things into that function that we know I know I need. So this one we definitely need, and these layers. So I'm gonna cut this out and paste them in here. And since this uses a weight here when it loads the level, we need to make this function async. There we go. And I don't think that's the only thing we need, but what we can move is this name. We're gonna feed that down into the load level function. And then we don't need to put Mario there, and we don't need to put scene runner, but we do need to add Mario to the scene in there and create the player environment. I just mentioned here how we passed by it that the player environment is going away soon. I think it just restarts the player when we die and keeps track of checkpoints and stuff like that. So let's move the level.entities.add and this one, the weight screen, this one, and not the input router right now at least, but then these two as well. So let's copy or paste that in there, and then copy move the scene runners in there as well. So I'm gonna add the scene runner scene or the weight screen first there, and then add the level scene last. Then I also think we should run the scene-runner.run next here. Scene-runner.run next in here. And that means that instead of running this immediately, we are gonna instead call run level, and we're gonna run 1-2 again here. So hopefully we didn't break anything, but we never know. Let's try it out. Refreshing. Huh. That seemed to work. I'm gonna change the code and see if we... Or actually, let me start another level. I'm gonna export the run level function. We could actually do only that. So instead of calling it explicitly here, I'm gonna just export it for now to the window. window.runLevel equals run level. And I just assign it to the window object here so I can reach it in the console. So that means now nothing happens when we click because we're not running a level, but I can run level in here. So I want to run 1-1 and 1-1 starts. Sweet. And now I'm gonna run 1-2. And we see immediately we have some problems. We need to clean something up. There's a little bit of a mess now. We are not pausing music anytime. So if the music has started playing, there is no callback to the audio player that it should stop playing. So we need to add that. And then I think you saw that we have this overlay. If I run 1-1 here, you can see that this renders on top of the level there. And the reason that happens is we're actually not painting level, but we're not clearing it either. So inside here you see that we paint the dashboard and we paint the player progress layer, and none of these are clearing the background. So what I'm gonna add here is actually just a clear layer that we're gonna implement. So we're gonna say wait screen .comp.layers.push, and I'm gonna create a new layer here that I call create color layer, and I'm gonna send in the code for black 000. So this color layer we're gonna create, we don't have this function yet. And let's create that from one of our other layers. Which one do we have? I think we should find something simple here. I think all of them are kind of simple. Let's just go with dashboard. I'm gonna save a copy of this as color.js, and we can remove most of the things here. Move that, and we rename it to create color layer. We don't need a font or a level, but we need a color. And we don't need this, but we do need this. We need to rename this a draw color. And we're gonna draw on the context. So everything we're gonna do inside here is this. We're gonna say context.fillStyle, I think, equals color. And then we're gonna say context.fillRectangle. We're going to fill it from 0, 0, and then fill the whole screen, which we can get from context.canvas, which is a reference to the canvas from the context, .width, and context.canvas.height, like that. And this might be the only thing we need for this layer. I'm going to save this, and then we need to import it here in the main file. I think we have the other layers here, so I'm going to import it between these. So create color layer is this called, and it's imported from layer/color.js. Let's see if that solved our problem. Let's run this level. And then we run another level. So that's nice. So now it clears the background and paints over it, so that the pixels that are in the existing context are not shining through. Perfect. Now let's attack the pause condition. So in scene runner, we can say here, when we say run next, we need to pause the currently running scene. So we can get out the current scene like this. And then if we have one, which we have unless the array is empty, we check current scene, and then we run current scene.pause here. So the reason I used the name pause is that I'm not using stop, because I think stop implies that everything's reset to nothing. Usually if you stop a CD player, it just stops the whole thing, but you pause it, we actually just can resume it. And that is the notion I have here, that we aren't actually stopping it forever, we're pausing it. But stopping it is essentially pausing it and just deleting the scene. That just wipes it from memory. So that's why I'm using that word pause here for this API. So let's go in the scene class, and we just add an update, no, pause function here. And in the normal scene, the one that doesn't really do anything, pause means nothing for now, so we just leave this empty. This means that we should, or let's console out that we're actually pausing here. Console.log pause, and we log out this to see what was paused. And let's try this out. Okay, nothing has paused there as expected. Then we run a level. Nothing has paused there. But there you see the composition scene was paused, even though it can't really be paused. So if I load another level here now, we see that it paused that level that was running. So if we implement pause in the level scene, we should be able to stop the music. So I'm opening the level class here. And here in the bottom, I will implement pause. And when pause is called, we should call this.music.pause. And that is, of course, the music controller here. I'm saving this file and then entering music controller. And this music controller uses a music player that we have here. So we should just call, implement pause here as well. And then we call this.player. Dot pause all. That should pause all the playing sounds in the player. So therefore we go into the player. It's not referenced here it seems, but it's at least here, music player. And we already have a pause all code, some pause all code here that we can cut out. So I'm gonna write pause all here. And I'm pasting in this and I'm fixing my typos. And then, of course, we should run this.pauseAll since we moved that code. So now we have implemented an API for pausing all the music. So let's see if we can get that to work. I'm running a level. Music starts playing. Running another level. Music stops. So that's beautiful, right? I think so. I think this is pretty beautiful. Now, I think we only have one thing left to do. Let me close some files here. And that trigger box. We're probably gonna need to load levels in many different ways, but our initial implementation will just be that the user or the player touches something, and that's when we do something. So first, I'm going to go in to the debug coin level, and I'm going to create a copy of this and call this debug progression.json. It's going to be super simple. It's not going to contain a coin, but instead we're going to create a trigger here. So triggers, I'm going to define which triggers we have, and this is a completely new configuration object in our JSON, level JSON. And the trigger I am going to create is going to be of type goto. And we might need to change these names later, but for now this is going to be goto, and it's going to go to something, go to a name. Yeah, let's call it name. And from this debug progression level, I want to go to 1-1. We also need to have a position, at least, so we know where this trigger is. And we're just going to put that at 64 and 64. We haven't done any of the reading of this code, but let's go into the level loader and see if we can check the triggers. So scroll up here to level. And in all these setup thingamajigs here, we should be able to... I'm going to create a function here that's called setup triggers, and it's going to take the level spec and the level, and then we define this new function somewhere. I think it seems good here after setup entities. So function setup triggers takes a level spec and the level, and let's log out level spec doc triggers. It may be null sometimes, but so we have the debug progression here, and we have checking setup trigger, run setup triggers. So let's go into main again and tell the system to load that new level we created. And main, and on init we run level debug progression. There we go. Let's see if we load that level properly now. So, loading debug progress, nothing's happening here. But are we seeing triggers? Yeah, here's a trigger we found. So far so good. Now we have to think about what the trigger should be. So I think trigger should be some kind of trait that contains some options. But first, let's look again in a level loader. I'm gonna close some files there that we don't need. This one and that one we might need. But this one we don't. There we go. First of all, if levelspec.triggers don't exist, then we just return from this function. Otherwise, we want to loop over them. So we say for const trigger spec of level spec.triggers, and let's log out each trigger, or each trigger spec, so to say. And before we continue too far, we're gonna check if it works. So we can see here that we find a trigger that's called goto, and it wants goto 1-1, and it wants to be at position 64, 64. As with many other things, I'm going to implement triggers as a trait. So let's find a trait folder. Let's start with emitter. It's a good base, I think. And I'm going to save this as trigger.js. I name it trigger. And I call it trigger here. Let's empty this and remove emit and remove the contents of update. But we need to have implement collides. And here we get that us and them. And what should we do with this? Well, if we collide with something, we want to register what we collided with. So we're gonna add a touches set here. touches equals new set. And if we touch something on a loop, then we add it to the touches set. So this.touches and add them to the touches. Then in the update function, we are gonna check if we touch anything. So if this.touches.size is more than 0, then what do? Well, we iterate over it. So for const, what do? We need to call something here for each touch. So I think we should add an array here called conditions. I don't know why I'm calling it that, but basically this is an array of things that we should be considered if something is touched for this. So for const condition of this.conditions, then we call the condition with this.touches, we call it with the game context, and we call it with the level. Yeah. I'm wondering if we should send with us ourselves as well here. But is it important to know which trigger it was? Actually, I think that it could be. So I'm gonna send in the entity here as well. So that is actually us here, an entity that we are on when we update is the same thing. But I'm not adding us here in the touches. I'm gonna just make this into underscore to disclose that, yeah, this variable comes in here, but we don't need it. But I think this trigger looks pretty good now. I'm gonna save that. And then we're gonna add this to the level in the level loader. So I think I'm gonna create a function here called create trigger. Function create trigger. And it's gonna be similar to this one. We call this the entity, and then we add the trigger trait to the entity, so new trigger here. And that trigger needs to be imported. Where do we have a trait here? So import trigger from triggers, no trigger from traits. And we added it here, and then we return this trigger entity. I'm not sure, should we have something more here right now? I think that's enough for now. So down here in the set of triggers, we're gonna create a trigger, const trigger equals create trigger. And what can we do here? So I guess we're gonna check the type of the trigger spec. So if trigger spec.type equals go to, then we say trigger.conditions.push, and what do we get out in this function? We get the who triggered. No, we actually get out ourselves. So we actually get out the trigger, we get out the candidates that triggered it. Should we call this the triggerers? Yeah, why not? We get the game context out. Not sure we need it. I'm going to call it GC here. And then we get out the level. Then here we need to check if it was a player that touched it. So for const player of, I'm not sure how I want to do this. But we need to find if anything. Oh, we don't need to do that at all. We can just say for const entity of triggers. Gonna copy paste that. Hard to spell. And if entity is a player, then what should we do? Yes, we should emit an event on the level. So level.events.emit. And I think we're gonna add an event to the level here. Yes, let's do that. So static event trigger. Or is this a good idea? I'm not sure. Event trigger. Yeah, let's generalize this. Event trigger equals symbol trigger. Yeah, let's do this. It's gonna be fun. Let's go into here the level loader, and now we have access to this static event trigger. And so let's emit it. Level.event trigger. And what do we trigger? I think we might be able to simplify this here. We probably don't need to check this here. We can probably just emit the entire trigger. Yeah, why not? Let's emit the trigger spec. Because why not? And that means we don't need this. And that looks like that might just work. Okay. Let's try that. Or actually, maybe we should just generalize it a little bit further. So for each condition, we just emit an event with the trigger spec, and we can emit the trigger, the entity that touched it, and the triggerers. I hope I don't need to pay for this sometime soon. Which means we can defer these checks somewhere else. Just remove this type with there. And that needs to be closed there. Okay, that looks good. So this means, oh, one more thing we need to do. We need to set the position of the trigger and add it to the level, of course. The trigger.position, and it's gonna be .set. And we need to set it at trigger spec.position 0 and trigger spec.position 1, I think. And then finally level.entities, entities.add, and we add the trigger there. Mm-hmm. And one thing, actually this should be called entity here, entity. And then we need to say entity.trigger. Maybe I should call this the entity here as well. Ah, let's do that. The entity, the touches, let's call this what they are. The touches, touches goes there, the trigger spec is there. And then we set the position, that is now the entity, and then we add the entity like that. So, was a little bit haphazard there, but what will happen now is that I will be able to listen to triggered events outside of the level that happens inside the level. Let's just see if this works at all, because high risk that I fucked it up. Okay, debug progress starts there. I can't see a trigger here. Probably did something wrong. So let's just log out the events. No, the entities dot log entity, so that we can see all the entities that were created. I also want to do another thing. It's too hard to wait here for the wait screen. So I'm gonna set the wait screen dot count down to 0.2. Here is an entity. The position is set. It doesn't have a size. So we can just default a trigger size, I think. So entity.position.set, and we say that all triggers are 64 by 64 units. Let's see here. And not showing up. What could that be? The reason I think it should show up, I mean, we don't draw anything in the trigger, but it show its collision zone should show up, the red thing here. So position 64 and 64, I expected it to be somewhere here. Ah, but the size, it's not set properly. Ah, typo. Ah, there it is. So let's see if we can listen to what happened here outside the level. Go back to main. And here, when we set up the level, we should be able to just create an event somewhere. I guess anywhere works. Let's try here. So level.events.listen. I want to listen to level.eventTrigger. And let's just log out all the arguments here. Console.log args. And then I think I need to import the level here, up here, so that I have access to that constant. And let's have a look. There we go. Hmm, it keeps emitting here. That's not right. So let's go into our trigger, and on every update loop, if there was any touches, we can clear it. So touches.clear. Only want it triggered when we are in it. Okay, nice. Why are we getting three of them? Oh, it's three arguments. So this is the spec that we got, and here is the entity that triggered it, which was the player. It should be the player at least. I expected a player. No, this is the trigger itself. And here, why is the set empty? Oh, it's because that's the instance of the set. So so basically, when I inspect this here in the console, the set is actually empty at the time I expand it. Because it doesn't copy all the data into the console on each iteration, which is nice. But this means that we should be able to do a little check there, and load a level if we need to. So we should be able to say, oops. Okay, what was the arguments now? The trigger itself, we can ignore it. Then the touches we have here, and was it the spec we have there? No. Let's see what we entered here. It's a spec, the touching entity, and the touches. No, the trigger that was triggered, and then the touches. So the spec, the trigger, and the touches. So we should look at all the touches for const entity of touches. And if entity is a player, then what do? Yes, we load a level. Or actually, what we probably should do up here is say that if spec.type equals go to, then we loop over all the entities, and if there is a player in there, so let's say it is a go to trigger and a player touched it, then we load the spec.name. So we say run level spec.name. I think this is it, and then we return here. Let's take a chance, see what happens. Oh, it worked! Fantastic! So now let's create a trigger on this level, and one trigger in the basement, and so we can jump between them. I thought it was so cool to see this for live, for real I mean. So let's have a like little higher countdown, and then we add a trigger to level 1.run. I'm gonna add it in the bottom here. Oh, there was already a trigger here. Ah, it's the wrong one, not one. Damn cache. So add a trigger that goes to 1-2, and this position should be fine. And then in 1-2, I want to have a trigger that goes back to 1-1. And let's see what we have. Okay, debug progress. Touch the trigger and we load world 1-1. And there's no trigger here. Why not? Maybe I didn't load the right file. Ah, that should be the right one. I'm actually gonna try to super refresh here. Empty cache and hard reload, just make sure we don't have a something lingering. Okay, we go there. What happened there? Oh, we're not resetting Mario's position, so we're inside the trigger immediately when it starts. That we need to fix, definitely. So let's go to main here. And I am going to reset Mario's position. Actually, what I'm gonna do is something more nefarious. I'm gonna add the input router here. Can I clear the input router? I'm not sure what I want to do here. But basically what my intent was to just create a new Mario every time so that Mario is completely reset. And maybe that's a little bit premature. Yeah, I'm not going to do that right now. But what I was thinking here was that I could remove Mario from the input receiver, input router. Then just throw away this instance of Mario, create a new one so that it's always on a good baseline. But for now, that might have some consequences that I'm not thinking about now, that I don't really have time for this in this episode. So let's do the thing we know how it works. Which means that before we add Mario to level, we say Mario.position.set and we reset him to 0, 0. So let's see how this pans out. There he is, boink. There we are. And that seems to be working out nicely. So we have some small side effects if we want painting Mario in the load screen as the way he looks in the last... if we jump there, we get a jumping Mario here. But I think that's kind of cute. We can fix it in many ways. We could reset more things. But we're gonna look at that problem once that becomes a huge problem. I think right now this is... I think it's kind of... kind of cute that that's how it works. So I think that's all we have for this episode. So thanks a lot for watching, and I hope you were able to take all this in, because it was quite a lot of things going on here.